Good. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our webinar, Youth Driven Change, High School Peer Leaders Speak on Their Experiences. Let me start off by introducing myself. My name is Yetzi Garcia-Martinez, and my pronouns are she, her, and I am a first-year youth board member with the California School-Based Health Alliance. Thank you for taking the time to be here today, as we're super excited to share with you folks all the amazing work that youth in California are doing at their high school campuses. Next slide, please. As some friendly reminders, in case you are having trouble with your audio, please feel free to dial in using the phone number in your registration link. We are also currently recording, but as you may have noticed, there's no option for participants to have microphones or cameras on, so this recording will only capture presenters, but we strongly encourage folks to use the chat throughout the presentations to send in questions and to also give shout outs to our amazing presenters. Please feel empowered to use the reactions feature as well. You all will also receive access to today's recording via email at a later date, along with any supporting material. If you're here today, it means you're either an adult ally, work with youth, or simply interested in peer-to-peer work. And here at CSHA, we do all that and more. We are a nonprofit organization dedicated to improving the health and academic success of children and youth by advancing health services in schools. And as a part of this work, CSHA is home to our youth board, which focuses on elevating youth voice and creating spaces like this webinar where youth can share the powerful work they are doing on their campuses. Now that you learned a little bit about our organization, I'd love to get to know who's in our audience today. So feel free to jump into the chat and share your name, title, and where you are joining us from. I'm joining today from Santa Cruz, California. Do we have anyone else in the Bay Area? Okay, we have LA in the house. Ooh, we got it coming in, San Francisco. Bay Area. Novato High School, okay. That's very close to me back home. We got people from all over today. This is so amazing to see. Oakland, Fresno. Madera. Ooh. Alameda County, okay. Wow, we got folks from all over California today. This is so cool. Fresno. San Bernardino County. We're covering all of California. Palmdale, San Bernardino County. Great. Okay, next slide. I'd love to tell you all about our organization's annual conference this year, Building Transformational School Health for California's Future, which will be hosted at the Santa Clara Convention Center on April 29th to 30th. Please click on the link in the chat for more information and registration details. We hope to see you all there. We also offer registration at a discounted rate for our members, technical assistance, and tools and resources. For more info, please see our membership link below in the chat. Now, the moment you have all been waiting for. Our presenters' lineup starts off with the incredible students from Pomona High School, followed by the extraordinary peer leaders of Clovis Unified School District and the amazing Antioch High School peer leaders. Let's give it up for our amazing presenters with a virtual round of applause. Take advantage of the reactions feature, y'all. It's the best. You can also go straight to the chat to give them a shout out. And I'll be your host, Yetzi, and without further ado, a warm welcome to the incredible peer leaders from Pomona High School.
Oh, that's weird. Okay, start. Let's go. We can go ahead and go to the next slide. All right, everybody. So this is the Use Your Heart Steps to Create a Peer Counseling Program by Pomona High School. Just to let you guys know, this presentation covers basically why we are, doing what we're doing. And it's just a quick overview about our program. Go ahead and click the next slide. So to start us off, I'm going to introduce myself. Hello, everyone. My name is Bella Moreno. I am a junior and a second year peer counselor. I'm a peer counselor because I just, want people, especially youth, to be heard and to have an advocate for each other. And I'm going to go ahead and pass it over to Brianna.
Okay, so hello, I'm Brianna Andrete. I'm a senior and a second year peer counselor. I hope to use the resources I've learned here in peer counseling to further my education and become a teacher. And now Mario.
So hello, everybody. I'm Mario, and I'm a first year peer counselor and also a sophomore. And I plan to use these skills that I've learned in peer counseling, such as active listening and problem solving. And now on with Jadine.
Hi, my name is Jadine. I am a first year peer counselor. I became a peer counselor because I want other people to know that they are not alone. Passing it to Jarius.
Hi, my name is Jarius. I'm a senior and a first year peer counselor. I'm a peer counselor because I really like the fact that I have the ability to really have an impact on somebody's day. And we're going to introduce Christaya next.
Hello, I'm Christaya. I am a first year peer counselor as well as a sophomore. I joined peer counseling mainly for myself, to manage myself, like my own emotions and learning more about what I can do. And next slide, please. Now we'll go and Bella will take it.
All right, everyone. So recruitment and application. So our recruitment and application process is different from some others. As we go into classrooms to present about our program, we do not bring applications with us. This is because students that are interested are signing up for an application. And as they sign up for an application, we come back to the classroom, we hand them an application, we leave it for about a week, then we come back to the classroom again, pick up the application, and so on. Why we do this is because we want to create a connection with the peer counselor and the student that is looking to apply. And for more information about our interviews, I'll hand it over to Brianna.
Okay, you can go on the next slide, please. So with our interviews, after the recruitment process is over, we start with the interviews. And this is typically one peer counselor will pick up the student from their classroom, and we will bring them in here to our lovely room A, as you can see a little bit. And typically 4 to 5 peer counselors will interview this student, and we ask questions to know more about their personality and know more about them and see if they're trainable and if we can work well with them. And now back to Bella.
Go ahead and go to the next slide. So how do we accept new peer counselors? So after the interview process is over, peer counselors come together as a whole and basically decide accept, decline, or probation to the applicant. And for decline, we are not declining the applicant at all from the program. We are simply just declining them from that year. They can reapply from the coming year. We're declining them because, maybe we don't think they're mature enough right now, or if they're just not going to be, like a good fit right now and they need to learn more. Probation is a 3-week trial period, and we also look for people who we need and people who need us. And I would like to pass it over to Mario.
So this is basically kind of how we train. So one of the most important parts of our training is confidentiality. And basically what confidentiality is that whatever is said between the client and the peer counselor stays between them and them only. And it'll only be broken in 3 cases. If 1, they're hurting themselves, 2, if someone's hurting them, and 3, if they're planning on hurting somebody. And then I would introduce them to my advisor, as I'm not trained for these types of situations. And the reason why we use confidentiality is because we want to keep that trust between the peer counselor and the client. And now on with our code of ethics. Basically, what our code of ethics is a very important contract that kind of works as a guideline for peer counselors to use that has the expectations of that come from them. And now on with Brianna.
You could go on the next slide. Thank you. Okay, so mandated reporting. As peer counselors, we are mandated reporters under the umbrella of our advisor, Ms. Balk. Mandated reporting falls under the California law, which is the Child Abuse and Neglect Reporting Act. As peer counselors, we do the mandated reporting like many other teachers and staff in schools. As peer counselors, we have to report under the four misdemeanors, which are physical injury, emotional abuse, sexual abuse, and neglect. And now to Jadine.
Okay, so our as peer counselors, we do not choose to use the like dead words such as bad, sad, good, like nice or happy. That way we can like continue bigger from that and like find more words that are better. So like frustrate, stressed or other bigger words, that way we understand our feelings better. And we do this to understand what we feel and not just short words. And we do not use try because there's no action in trying. And we don't use why either, because why leads to a dead conversation, like I don't know. And can you go to the next slide? So continuing this, this is our certification checklist. This helps us again with statement of feelings. If they give us a dead word like mad, we would give them with a more bigger word like frustrated, irritated, and it just helps them understand what they're feeling. And so we start off with the introduction, then we go to brainstorming so they take ownership for what they decide to do, and then the conclusion. On to Mario.
So here in peer counseling, we have three different types of questions that we like to ask. So the first one is open-ended questions. With open-ended questions, we use those to kind of just get them to speak a little bit more. And those types of questions, you can't answer with a yes or no. And speaking of yes or no questions, we have closed-ended questions. And with those are able to be answered with a yes or a no. And our third type of question that we like to ask is clarification questions. And those kind of help us understand the situation a little bit more, just so we know that like we're following along and that kind of like, how do you say it? That we can find out more of like the situation. And while we're having like a session with them, we do paraphrase a lot. And we use paraphrasing to let the client know that they're being heard and that they, like, we know that, like what they're saying. And so on with Jarius.
Can we go to the next slide, please? Okay, and then can you hit next a couple times? Because there's bullet points that are going to pop up. Okay, validate, validate, validate. Validating is like one of the key things for a session to go properly, okay? Validating is important because as you're talking to your client, it's one of like the key things that you have to do is like kind of help them feel comfortable with what they're thinking or any ideas that they give you, okay? When someone gives you an idea, it's very hard to get anything out of them if they feel uncomfortable with what they're saying. All right, so making them feel comfortable with what they're saying is like really, really important in making sure that the rest of everything goes smooth. All right, and now back to Mario, sorry.
All right, next slide, please. So with brainstorming, we want to brainstorm so that we can help the client take control of their situation and so that they can create an action plan for themselves. And we want them to, like, well, we want to brainstorm with them and not brainstorm for them, you know, so that they can take control and that their action plan is theirs. And so now here with Christina.
Okay, so to tell you a little bit about the intake form for the freshmen, this is an important document for us. That being, because for one, this is to show that we like introduced ourselves. Not only that, we had a session with our client, and this is just something that kind of proves that in a way. It is very important in our scenario or our cases. Now to pass it to Bella. You can go ahead and go to the next slide. All right, so restorative circles and mediations. So before we used to use
the, I guess, the old mediation guidelines, but now we are using restorative circle guidelines. This, in a sense, just helps us move the mediation more smoothly. And as you can see on the slide, there we have questions for wrongdoers. So, like, what happened? What were you thinking about at the time? What have you thought about since the incident? And what do you think you need to do to make things right? And we also have some questions for those that have been affected by the wrongdoing. So, like, what did you think when you realized what had happened? What effect has this incident had on you and others? And what has been the hardest thing for you? And I'd like to pass it back to Brianna.
Okay, thank you. PC evaluation. So every year at the end of the semester, we like to have our freshmen and our clients not rate us in a sense, but kind of like, so that we could get a better understanding of what we need to do better, what we need to improve on, what we did well. And that's pretty much it about our evaluations. We're not allowed to see them. Only our advisor, Ms. Balk, is allowed to see them. And now I will pass it to Jarius.
Freshman support. All right. So one of like the most important things, again, about being a pre-counselor is our freshman support. That's like one of the key things. We start off the beginning of the year with our freshman orientation, where we open up the school, we let them come in, we give them tours so that they can familiarize themselves with the campus, and we introduce them to all their teachers. After this, we follow along with them through the year with birthday cards, holiday cards, and we regularly come in, we pull them out, talk about their grades, just check on them, and we let them know that if they ever need anything, they can always come find us. And now, back to Mario.
Next slide, please. So to begin with, we have educational presentations. So one of the first ones we did this school year was drug presentations, where we would kind of help spread awareness and also provide resources if any students needed help with that type of thing, or, you know, like just someone to talk to about it. And we also have other events around campus, such as Red Ribbon Week, eighth grade extravaganza. Well, that one's not on campus, but we do that event at other schools. And suicide prevention. And now on with Bella. I mean, not Bella, Cristina, sorry.
Next slide, please. Thank you. Okay, so as for the managerial practices, this is something for ourselves, kind of in the sense we are our own boss in a way, unless we need help from our advisor. We basically have everything controlled most of the time, and that's that part. As for the tasking duties, everybody is assigned a task in this classroom. If a person is absent, it kind of makes it harder for the flow that we have going on around this. And then for one person that has their job, they also have to, like, in a way, help with the person that isn't here. And that kind of just, like, unbalances it in a bit, well, in a way, and it doesn't really help. Now I'll pass it back to Bella.
Okay, so in addition to us going out and seeing our clients and our freshmen, we also get students that walk into our center who do need assistance. So the client sign in, so any peer counselor can come in, help the students sign in on our sheet. The sign-in sheet helps us keep track of students who are coming in and out. And as the student is signing in, we like to ask what kind of services they need, so if they would like to be alone for a bit or if they would like to speak to a peer counselor. And the walk-ins can be any student in any grade. And I'd like to pass it back to Brianna.
Okay. Next slide, please. Thank you. Okay, so our clipboards are lovely clipboards. These are used as a hall pass for us, and they hold our notes, our case notes, or just anything that will help us move a session smoothly. Like I said, our clipboards are used as a hall pass, so we're allowed to use them on campus, outside of the classroom, so that staff and security know that we're strictly on peer counseling duty, that we're having a session, or whatever needs to be done within our clipboard use, that we're not like just walking around or messing around or just trying to be outside of class. They know that we're strictly using these for our pre-counseling duties. So back to Jerry's.
And now a little about TUPE, okay? TUPE, or the Tobacco Use and Prevention Education Program, is a grant-funded program that helps us set up interactive tents and tables where people can walk up and inquire knowledge about the harmful effects of tobacco with things like games, You know, we've done things where we put on goggles and people can just kind of see how it feels to be under the influence. Or sometimes, you know, we'll use real things. Like last time, we brought in real pig lungs and people could really see the difference between healthy lungs and like damaged lungs. And it's just a really effective way of being able to get our message about tobacco use and prevention to like our campus. And now to Bella again.
All right, guys, so our legacy bricks. At the end of the year, every peer counselor will paint a brick, basically leaving a legacy for new peer counselors to just, I guess, to be inspired about becoming a new peer counselor that year. And so, yeah, so every, you know, peer counselor gets to be able to paint their very own brick. And what I love about this is that this year I get to paint my second brick, and next year I'll be painting my last brick, which is going to be a little bit emotional, but it'll be really fun to leave a legacy here. And for the new peer counselors coming in, basically to look up to me. And I'll close it off with Jadine.
So lastly, we have our peer counseling mascots, Duncan and Zola. They do join us on Saturday school certification or other things. And do you guys have any questions or comments or concerns?
Can we please get a huge virtual round of applause for Pomona High School? It was so amazing to hear about your guys' program. I loved hearing about all the aspects that you guys have in it, including, you know, validating feelings and really paying attention to active listening and supporting freshmen. The fact that y'all just go out there and actually keep checking in on them. I remember getting a tour, but I don't remember having anything past that. So that's amazing that y'all's high school is doing that. So during these next 5 minutes, folks, please feel free to send in your questions in the chat. While we wait for some questions to roll in, we did get some while you all were presenting. One question we got from Megan in the chat is, when are you trained? Is peer counseling a CTE pathways class or more of a program? When do peer counselors meet with students?
We are not CTE.
I can talk about when we are trained. So we are trained pretty much throughout the year, but the part where we mainly train is early October, and we do hold Saturday school trainings. So we'll hold 5 or 6 Saturday school trainings. So we'll come in, train, learn all the information that we need to learn. And yeah, that's basically it.
Great. And how often do the peer counselors meet with their students?
Real fast, we are not CTE. Yeah. When do we meet? Tuesdays, T-shirt Tuesday.
When do we meet? We usually meet about every single week on Tuesdays where we use our T-shirts, or if the client is in need, or like if we feel like we do need to check up on them, then we'll just go and pull them out of class with our clipboards.
Nice. Go ahead.
Or our freshmen or our clients can typically just like walk in and ask our advisor if they can find us or if they need a peer counselor. So whenever, really.
And that you need to be up to date in your other classes.
You do need to be up to date on your classes, though. All your grades have to be maintained.
For sure. That's an important aspect. So another question that we got in the chat from Allison is, I'm noticing that I'm getting a lot more interest in signing up for peer counselors among girls than boys. Any tips on recruiting boys?
Well, you guys can answer that one.
That's a good question. I mean, I don't know how to feel about that because, you know, like, I don't feel like as if it's any different from recruiting girls, you know, because, like, you know, we're all just people. We're all just people, you know? So if you can recruit girls, you know, you can also recruit girls. I mean, boys the same way.
And I was going to say, too, to really show people, like, the programs and the things that we do and the opportunities that are given to us. Because I know that a lot of, like, the caring for people and, like, you know, sitting down and talking to people, I know that that normally does usually appeal to more women. But I feel like, you know, when you really do present the opportunities that we do, the things that we do, the people that we talk to, you know, the presentations that we give, that could pull more people in. both male and female.
And we do have 9 guys.
Yeah, and we do have about 9 peer counselors with us too. So it's like a...
Yeah, we have 9 males total.
All right. Thank you all so much for answering that. I think we can fit in about one more question. For those that don't qualify for the first time, do you all keep up with them to get them ready to qualify for the next year?
Let me answer that one. What we do is we don't track them because we just don't have the capacity to do so. However, we do invite them to help us out. Like, so if we're going to have a pop-up thing, you know, if they want to help us set up, that's cool. Our center is open for break and lunch. And so, you know, if they come and hang out with us, that kind of stuff, just to keep themselves in the loop, then fine. If they can't because their schedule, it doesn't fit their schedule, they do not have to reapply. They can just join the next year. So we don't make them go through the interview process a second time.
All right. Another question that we got is, how are clients and counselors matched?
That's awesome. You want me to answer that one?
I mean, I feel like we can answer that.
Okay, cool.
Well, okay, at the beginning of the year, we're given intake forms and we're all assigned different freshmen, but that's just for the freshmen. For actual clients or like people who do need help when they come in, it's kind of like an on-the-site thing, or like if our counselor feels like someone really does need support, she, you know, kind of has like a feel for all of our strengths and weaknesses, so she'll assign us to someone who, you know, we best fit.
And they can ask for somebody else.
And they can ask for someone else too.
But really fast, we make sure that the client knows that it's their right to change, you know, to change peer counselors. We don't take it personally. And peer counselors also know that, hey, if I don't have any chemistry with my client, it's okay to ask to switch as well. And sometimes we have a male and a female for one client just because that's what's needed.
Thank you so much for answering that question. A question that we got based on the structure of the program: how many sections are offered? How many years has the program been in place? And do you limit your class sizes?
Well, we have 3 levels. And then we also have what we call peer service, which is, so somebody asked about our wellness center. That's a sore spot with us because we've been called the wellness center for the last 10 years. And then, you know, they put this other thing in a different room somewhere else. But, where's the question again? I don't want to go over it. Where was it again?
How many years has the program been place?
So the at Pomona Unified, here we have had consistently since the 1980s. This was not my idea. I started in 1996. Right now we have 2 sections. So we have a beginning section and an advanced section, and then we have an advisory that's just for peer counselors. We do cap it at 25, and we do not take freshmen.
All right. I love the enthusiasm of this program. Thank you so much, everyone, for your questions. And if we didn't get to your questions, there will be contact information shared at the end of this webinar if you'd like to get in touch. Thank you so much for your informative presentation, Pomona. Next up, we have the incredible peer leaders from Clovis Unified School District.
Good afternoon, everyone. We represent the Clovis Unified Peer Counseling Program. Today, we are talking about peer counseling's impact on student mental and behavioral health. Next slide, please. Oh, wait, never mind. We already have our picture on it. So, my name is Lucas Chamberlain. My pronouns are he, him. I am a senior and a 2-year peer counselor at Clovis High School. And I'm joined by...
My name is Sydney Harrison. I use she, they pronouns. I've been a peer counselor for 4 years and I'm a senior.
Yes. Okay. I'm Bailey McPherson. I've been a peer counselor for 5 years. I use she, her pronouns, and I attend Clovis West High School.
Hi, I'm Larissa, and I go to Clovis West. This is my third year as a peer counselor, and my pronouns are she, her.
Hello, everyone. My name is Juan Garcia. I go by the pronouns he, him. I'm a 12th grader. I've been a peer counselor for 4 years, and I go to Clovis High School. Next slide, please.
There's our intro. Okay. Well, peer advocacy on CUSD campus. Next slide, please. This was.
Oh. Okay. So, why is peer counseling effective? Peer counseling has many positive effects on students. It encourages peers to accept themselves and whatever the situation they're experiencing, and therefore supporting their mental health and their well-being through the curriculum tactics that we will speak about shortly. It also encourages positive peer relationships, both amongst personal relationships and the relationships between peer counselors and students, which in result benefits their behaviors in school. Sometimes a student just needs someone their age to relate to and to talk to that isn't their parent or an adult. And sometimes it's easy for students to feel misunderstood. So when they speak to a trained student that is at the same spot in life as them, they can feel heard. And really all it takes is one person to accomplish that. So building on that, peer counseling can allow students to feel less alone as they're communicating their feelings and gaining validation from their peer. It decreases a sense of loneliness that is super common in high school. So, yeah. The program also just instills pro-social habits and attitudes within both the peer counselor and the student. So peer counseling benefits the peer counselor by creating positive communication skills, developing empathetic habits, and helping to have a sense of self, while the peer counselor also develops their character and provides an example and support for their peers. So, thank you. Excellent. Next slide.
Here are some interesting facts about peer counseling. So currently 60% of our students have felt that peer-to-peer support was very helpful to them with any support they needed, which helps our program with identifying what more we need to do to help or support our students. Next, our 82% of our students acknowledge that us peer counselors are well-trained and able to serve and support students of various backgrounds and cultures, specifically because us as a program are very diverse. Lastly, 80% of trained peer counselors have felt that their training was fair to other peer counselors and that all the curriculum has been beneficial. Next slide.
Tiers of support. Mental health support is stratified in 3 tiers to provide targeted support to students who need it most. Tier 1 is available to all students. Tier 2 and 3 are available to select students, typically by teacher recommendation or referral. And next slide, please.
So the first part of our tier 1 supports is peer counseling, and that is because any student can refer themselves or be referred by another student who is worried about them to peer counseling, as well as teachers able to make the recommendations to our advisor to have their student placed in peer counseling. All students have access to these forms through QR codes that are spread out on campus, as well as links that are provided on like our Instagram page or from teachers that can recommend them. Peer counselors are trained to offer solution-oriented talks to students in need who may feel that they need a little bit more support in life. Next slide, please.
All right, and now we're going to talk about the second half of the Tier 1 support, which is a CSI. So CSI stands for Clovis Support Intervention and offers support groups for students of basically any sort of variety of topics and for anyone. So basically can ensure that we can help almost anyone on campus. Students can join this. They could be freely joined. You could just show up or attend one, or you can be referred by someone on campus. That could be like maybe one of your teachers, a peer, or someone like that. And then the attendance can be mandated in a youth court if it is deemed beneficial, but at the end of the day, it's just there to help out students and to be the best resource we can for them. Next slide, please.
So our tier 2 supports as it relates to peer counseling is the peer counseling class. So peer counseling is only available to certain students who meet different requirements, including having a 2.5 GPA and getting a recommendation by a teacher or administrator. And this is just to ensure that our pre-counseling class is full of leaders and people who will be good leaders on campus. Students have to submit the application the year prior to the year that they want to be in peer counseling. So currently we have our application open so people can apply to join for the 24-25 school year. Next slide, please.
All right, so for tier three, we like to offer professional support for the students that need most. And basically what this is as peer counselors, we can only go so far as to help the people that we're like being our clients, but we offer many school support systems. Some of those could be school psychologists, or they could be school like mental health leaders. People like that are teachers or counselors. And this support is basically there to provide further support for the students that beyond what we can contribute to them. So overall, to get them more help. Next slide, please.
So this is part of our curriculum that we learn as peer counselors before we're certified to go and talk to students, which usually happens around this time of year. Personally, Clovis High was just certified all of our peer counselors to go and talk with students. But depending on the high school campus, they finish their curriculum anywhere between 8 weeks to a full semester. So what we learn is social emotional communication skills, including the difference between empathy and sympathy. And in our terms, that's kind of like we try and stick more towards empathy, because empathy is putting yourself in someone else's shoes, while sympathy is feeling sorry for someone. We also try and understand that all people judge each other, and we try and understand our own judgments and our own biases so we're able to serve students of any background without judging them. We also do something called not shoulding on our clients, which includes not telling our clients what they should do in situations, but instead telling them what they could do and presenting them with options and deciding where they want to go from there. We also, in our communication skills, which applies to how we talk to our students, as well as what some tools that we can give them to talk to people in their lives they may be having conflict with, includes active listening, so making sure we're making eye contact, nodding our heads, making sure that they know that we're fully present in our sessions. We also learn the full counseling process, which is just a list of things that we try and go through every session to ensure that our students find some sort of solution that they feel happy with at the end of the day. And the other part of our job as peer counselors is being able to identify students in crisis and take them to campus safe spaces to ensure that they get the help that they need, especially if it's outside of what we're comfortable dealing with as peer counselors. So part of that is our limits of reporting, which you'll see in our mock session that's about to come up, is we have to report anything that has to do with harm to self, harm to others, harm to property, or any form of abuse. Next slide, please.
Okay, so me and Larissa are just gonna kind of give a short example of what a session would kind of look like. So as you're watching, please keep in mind the curriculum that we just talked about and try to take note of seeing what skills were utilized during the session. So I'm going to be the peer counselor and Larissa is going to be the student. Okay, so hi, my name is Bailey. What's your name?
My name is Larissa.
Nice to meet you. So I'm a peer counselor. You were referred to peer counseling. Do you know what peer counseling is?
I don't.
Okay, so peer counseling is just a group of students on campus who are here to provide support for you in whatever area of your life you need it. Do you know what confidentiality is?
I don't.
So confidentiality just means that everything we talk about is going to stay between just you and I, unless it involves our duties to inform, which is harm to self, harm to others, or others harming you. And in that case, if you were to share that information with me, I would have to inform my advisor so that we could get you the help that you need that I don't have the power to give you. Okay. Okay, do you have any questions?
I don't.
Are you comfortable with continuing?
Yeah.
Okay, what's going on?
Lately, I've been feeling a lot of stress.
Okay, why is that?
It kind of started when I had failed my last math test, and I've just been stressing because I really want to pass my next one.
Yeah, I'm really sorry. I know how stressful that can be. How has that been impacting you?
It made me feel really, disappointed in myself, so I've just been, really down lately with, just in class. I don't really pay attention as much.
Yeah, I understand that. Is there any particular reason why you haven't been paying attention or why you feel like you've been doing poorly?
I think lately I've just been a little stressed and, mm-hmm. I just get really distracted.
Yeah. Why are you getting distracted in class?
I have like really good friends in that class, and we really like talk a lot, and I know we shouldn't, but like we do, and I usually will just go on my phone and I really won't listen to my teacher.
Yeah, I completely understand that. I know in high school when, your friends are in your class or you aren't really feeling the subject that you're listening to, it's really hard to stay paying attention. So don't feel bad about yourself for kind of feeling like you're getting distracted a lot. Do you feel like these distractions have really been impacting your grade?
Yeah, I think that's really why I didn't know like the material that was on my last test. And so when I like failed, I kind of figured that maybe it was because of all the stuff that I wasn't paying attention to.
Okay, yeah. So have you talked to your teacher about these concerns?
I have, and I kind of was just disappointed in my grade, and he could tell. So he did pull me aside and he talked to me, and he just recommended that if I needed more help, that I should go in during lunch and I should really just ask him like about certain like equations that I'm not really understanding, and that he said he would help me.
Okay. And do you feel like that would benefit you and benefit your grade and stress levels?
I think it really possibly could. I just haven't because I just haven't made the time to. But I think if I really did take the time to, that maybe my grade would go up and I would understand better what he's teaching and really know my material for my next test.
Yeah, okay, I'm really glad you've come to that conclusion. So are you planning on taking action anytime soon?
I think I could do that maybe tomorrow because I do have a test coming up on
Okay.
Monday. And I think it would be good for me to go in and just really ask certain things. And I think he could help me. And I think that would probably be the best option that I have right now.
Okay, awesome. Okay, so you were feeling really stressed and you were feeling really down about your grade. So you're planning on tomorrow to go talk with your teacher and kind of see what you're missing and try to put all the pieces together so you can improve your math grade. Is that correct? Okay, perfect. So I'm going to be back with you next week and
Okay.
you can tell me all about how that conversation went and how your math test went. And if it went well, then we can celebrate together and see if we can make a plan so that your grade can keep improving. And if it goes poorly, then we can find another solution that works for you so that you don't have to be stressed all the time. Is that
Okay.
okay?
Yeah, that
Okay.
sounds great.
Thank you
Thank
so
you.
much. Okay, so that was a mock session. It was pretty quick. Usually they're a lot longer than that. But yes, the problems that students come to us can range anywhere from problems with school to grief. So it's kind of like the steps of how to be in a session.
Next slide. Okay, so this is me, sorry. Okay, so every year since 2021, CUSD has held a peer counseling summit, and this includes students from 7th to the 12th grade. And we get training, and we get to know other students from the other sites, and we get to learn more about certain things that will come up our way as being a peer counselor. So we could play that video now.
Summit held today.
Maybe choosing to give a little bit more in some area of our lives too.
Hundreds of Clovis Unified students gathered at the Clovis Veterans Memorial Building Monday.
What are some things we need to do?
The third annual Peer Counseling Summit was organized by Derek Davis, the District Peer Counseling and Clovis Support and Intervention Coordinator. It included students from every junior high and high school in the district.
They want to counsel and help other students. They have a heart to care for other people.
Davis says peer counseling is a college prep class and students must apply to get in. The goal is for students to offer support services to peers and, most importantly, be there to listen to a class made in need without judgment.
It's just a safe place for them to share their thoughts, feelings, and concerns, and for the peer counselor to help guide them through whatever they're going on.
I'm able to listen to them.
One of those peer counselors is Sukhman Sidhu, a senior at Clovis East. He was recognized Monday for being one of the few students who have been in the program for 4 or more years. Conversation with classmates are confidential unless it includes harm to self or others. Sidhu says he's worked with a variety of students in need, from those struggling in school to another student who just needed a friend.
Sometimes students want to talk to us because they need someone our age and just have someone there who they can rely on, because some kids don't trust adults on campus.
The summit included group work, and students heard from a motivational speaker, Kevin Zawala, who's known as Mr. Peace. He highlighted worthiness, self-love, and spreading it to others.
And all of us have that same power to be that light to someone's heart if we choose to.
Students like Sadu plan to take what they learn and apply it as they support their peers through everyday challenges.
I'm at least hopeful that that person who I'm talking to at least gets the help they need, and at least their situation gets a little bit better.
Peer counseling extends beyond just supporting their classmates. These students also regularly create awareness events around important topics like mental health, suicide prevention, and drug prevention. In Clovis, Jessica Harrington, ABC 30 Action News.
Okay, so how we reach students. We reach students by being very active within our campuses. We spread awareness through in-depth presentations in classrooms a couple times a year that consists of how these students can reach a peer counselor, what the program is about, and how they can become a peer counselor as well. In doing this, we also like to inform students of our confidentiality policies that we just learned about and how we can function as a program. Every teacher and staff member also has our posters around campus with information regarding our program and how to schedule a session. And these posters are also in most public spaces, such as hallways, bathroom stalls, offices, anywhere that's super high traffic to attract students. And all of them do have QR codes on them that they could just scan so that it's easy access to schedule a session, and it's very private, so their information isn't being seen by other students. Next slide.
So peer counselors host a variety of events and activities to reach the student body. We often host lunchtime activities for awareness months, like Suicide Prevention Awareness Month, Red Ribbon Week, Mental Health Awareness Month, and more. These often include backyard games, candy, and activities like the vent box shown here. The vent box is on a table placed in a high traffic area. Students are prompted to write whatever is weighing on their mind and put it into the box. From there, it'll be shredded, and hopefully the worry that comes with it will go away. The goal of this event in particular is to boost awareness of mental health topics and to highlight to students that we care and are here to support. Thank you all for listening. And with that being said, now would be the perfect time to answer any of those burning questions you have.
Can we please get a virtual round of applause for Clovis Unified School District? You all did amazing. I loved hearing about the curriculum that you all learn, and it's clear that y'all's communication skills are well developed. It was great seeing the mock session example with Bailey and Larissa. You both did great, and you're all such great leaders for your peers. All right, folks, if anyone has questions, please feel free to drop them into the chat. We did get a few while y'all were presenting. So one question that we got from Selena was, did you all build your own peer counseling curriculum, or was it developed by someone else?
So the peer counseling curriculum was actually developed by someone else, and we're still currently working with them on new iterations, you know, as the years go on. But there's a standardized curriculum throughout the district that we all use to train our peer counselors, and at each school site, it looks relatively similar.
It's great to hear that y'all go back and check in on that curriculum regularly. Another question that we got is, what if a student comes in with thoughts of hurting themselves or others? How do you handle the situation?
Okay, so there have been a lot of instances where students do come to us talking about, you know, wanting to harm themselves or someone else, or if they're in danger, because it's easier for them to talk to students their age. And in that scenario, because we've already informed them of our confidentiality limits in our introduction, they are fully aware that that information will be shared with our advisor so they can get the proper help they need. And from that moment on, our advisor, who are mandated reporters, will report that. Us as peer counselors, if we become uncomfortable with the conversation after that, we can bring them to our advisor to either have another peer counselor step in, or our school psychologist, or whoever can support them. But once they share that, the session doesn't just stop immediately. We just keep supporting them and talking to them until the session is over, and that's when we go talk to our advisor.
It's great to hear. Monica asked in the chat, when did you know that the curriculum was needed? And what do you do as a peer support counselor for your own self-care?
Could you repeat the beginning of that question, please?
Yeah, and if you guys don't have a direct answer, that's totally cool too, since I know that y'all aren't developing this curriculum yourselves. But the question was, when did you know that the curriculum was needed? Maybe like going back and revising it. And then the second part of the question is, what do you do as a peer counselor for your own self-care?
Well, to answer the first part of the question, like any other class, curriculum has to be updated as more knowledge is gained within the field. And that's really having a standardized curriculum. One serves the purpose of, you know, putting forth a united front in terms of what we do as a district, and also to make sure that we're all on the same page. And that, you know, let's say someone transfers, they'll be right up to speed if they join that class, or they'd be able to support a peer from any other school. And the second part of the question, I think we all relate, you know, peer counselors across the schools, that we got into this because we are interested in mental health, whether it be from personal experience, knowing someone who has had mental health struggles, or just wanting to learn how to communicate better as a person. And I think we all have been able to extrapolate what can be used within a session to every interpersonal communication that we engage in.
Would anyone else like to answer the part about what y'all do for your own self-care as a peer counselor?
I can answer that. I think the main thing that we take away from our curriculum is that we're not only using that curriculum to give to our students, is we're using that curriculum on ourselves as well. So the things that we, the tools that we advise them with, the things that we prompt are things that we use in our own life. And part of that is scheduling time for self-care. So sometimes when students come to us, if they're someone who's a really high achieving student and they're having a really hard time saying no and having to saying no to like different activities or different things that are being asked of them, and they're really having a really hard time scheduling time for themselves, we know from our personal experience that you have to take that time for yourself. You have to schedule different self-care activities, whether that's reading a book or doing an activity that you like. We know from personal experience that you have to take time for yourself in order to help others.
That was such a great response. Thank you so much. All right. Another question that we got in the chat was, does your school have a wellness center? If so, do you work together?
I think the answer to that question is no. Bailey, go ahead. Sorry.
I was going to say, I don't think, I'm not sure if Clovis High has a wellness center, but Clovis West does not. I don't necessarily know what a wellness center is. So yeah, we have, if a wellness center is groups that support students, we absolutely have those resources. I just think they're more split up and not considered a wellness center.
All right, another question that we got in the chat from Allison was, what happens if a counselor breaks confidentiality?
Okay, so one thing that will happen is if a counselor does break confidentiality, it could result in being possibly kicked from the program, just because the topics that we're dealing with these students are so serious, and this is not information that we can take lightly and can just be like talked around and start spreading rumors. This is like a serious thing that we're dealing with. So the punishments for breaking your confidentiality is pretty serious, like getting kicked out of the classroom or getting kicked out of class in general, which I feel like is good because it creates a sense of security for the students that they know when they're talking with us, that what they're communicating with us will stay confidential. They don't have to worry about all their information possibly getting put out there.
Yeah, and the reason for, you want to go ahead, Lewis?
Yeah, I kind of just wanted to add on to that because we do sign a code of ethics at the beginning of the school year, and it does go over like we really can't break our confidentiality as well as things for ourselves that we can't do on campus. But going with that, yeah, we sign that we're not allowed to break confidentiality and we could get in trouble for doing so.
Yeah, confidentiality is definitely important. Thank you for sharing about that. All right, another question that we got is, how do you advertise your peer-to-peer program at your school in a way that gets students motivated to sign up as mentees?
We try and make sure that people know that talking to a peer counselor is not something to be ashamed of, and everyone needs some sort of supporting figure in their life. So we try and say it in a way of like peer counseling is not just for students who have an issue in their life or someone that needs help. It's also for people who just want to talk, who just have something that they want to vent. They don't want to find a solution. They just need to talk to us. So we try and make sure that students know that anyone can come to us no matter what walk of life they're in.
Yeah, and to make students kind of feel motivated to become peer counselors, we do a lot of activities at lunch, not just for people who need support, but at our various awareness months, such as sexual assault awareness, suicide prevention, teen like dating and violence, or whatever awareness months we have, we do a lot of activities at lunch. We make posters, there's Instagram posts, we go around to classrooms, we talk to people. And I think a lot of it is like proof is in the pudding. Like a lot of peer counselors just have bring their friends into the program because, you know, birds of a feather flock together. So we have a lot of good people who know good people, and our program just grows as a community the more we talk to each other.
Great. Thank you so much for answering that. All right. We have another question here. What was the most challenging part of becoming a mentor? Was there any resistance you faced from peers? If so, how did you overcome it?
I'd say the most challenging part of becoming a peer counselor was the overall mental health stigma. It's gotten drastically better in the last few years, I would say. But in the beginning, there was definitely like, oh, you're in peer counseling? Like, what even is that? I'd say not only the stigma, but the overall lack of awareness of the program made it to where it's like, oh, I don't even know what you're doing. And then a way that I personally overcame it, and I think we can all relate to this, is just telling them what it's about. And tell them how passionate we are about it. And usually people will respect that. And, you know, I think we do some great stuff here. And people can see that in, you know, the way that we all talk about this program.
Yeah, it's clear to me that you all are very passionate about the work that you do. Thank you all so much for presenting. And thank you everyone in the chat for your insightful questions. Next up, we have the phenomenal peer leaders from Antioch High School.
Hi, I'm the adult ally, Shira Schweitzer from Antioch High School. We had a student not show up today, so I'm going to be taking one of his slides. And I'm going to introduce, next slide, please, our wonderful Antioch High School peer advocates. We're at Antioch. We are building stronger campus communities through youth-to-youth work and restorative practices. And this is Kira, and she's going to start us out.
Next slide. So my name is Kira. I'm in Advanced Peers 2. These are the other people that are going to be presenting as well. Malia in Advanced Peers 2, Dominic in Advanced Peers 2, Brendan in Advanced Peers 3, and Sid Lolly in Advanced Peers 2. Next slide.
So the history of our peer program began in 2015. We started with one class and 10 students. Currently, we have about 70 students in the program, and we have about 35 advanced peers who have been in the program for 2 or 3 years, and 35 beginning peers who are currently being trained in the communication skills. Some of the things that the program does are included in our discipline matrix and our care team interventions. Next slide.
Hi, I'm Dominic. So what is the Antioch High School Peer Program? I'm going to be talking about the beginning peers and learning the skills. So in order to get into this class, you first have to go through an interview and you need to have at least one teacher recommendation. The things that we do learn about in this class is you learn about teamwork and team building skills. You learn about identifying needs and the icebreaker, which is an activity to identify and notice the needs of our different students. They go over communication skills such as nonverbals, body language, and open and closed questions. We train them in PI as well as conflict mediations, and they also help the advanced peers with the community building activities at the school.
Oh, back to the last slide. So hi, I'm Aaliyah. I'm gonna be talking about advanced peers, putting the skills into actions. We have two sections with approximately 30 students. It's a daily class. We have second and third year peers. We do team building. We plan and lead community activities on campus. We implement PI meetings and facilitate conflict mediations. We act as advocates and mentors for students in need, mostly for ninth graders for the mentoring. And then we also create curriculum and we interview students wanting to become peers. And we also help organize Start with Hello Week and set up and provide help with the holiday coat drive that we host at our high school. Next slide.
So I'm gonna be talking about what the peer advocates do. So the things that we do as peer advocates, we do one-on-one meetings and peer mentoring. We also do conflict mediation. We also do PIES, which is Peer Intervention Education, which is a pilot with the CCCOE, which stands for the Contra Costa County of Education. We do campus community building activities, such as Start with Hello Week. We create and teach lessons about relevant topics to other classes on campus. We also help Deer Valley High School build their peer program, as well as showcase our program to other educators to help build peer programs in districts across the state. Next slide.
So how is the program accessed? Our program is accessed through QR codes, flyers, business cards, which I have an example right here, and Instagram, drop-ins, online forms, referrals from staff on campus, middle school referrals, mentoring, which is basically where Schweitzer, the teacher, contacts middle school asking for names of incoming ninth grader students who would benefit from a mentor, and then student referral, self-referral, or stop students with badges on. So we do have badges that we wear once we are peer certified, and any student can stop us at any moment at school. And our care team intervention and part of the discipline matrix. Next slide.
Okay, I'll be reading a quote of the rationale. No better preventionist training exists than peer collaboration and cooperative learning programs that engage youth in mutual problem solving, decision making, and conflict resolution in a climate of mutual helping and respect, by Bonnie Bernard. I agree with this just off my own personal experience that when you're working with someone your own age, you're more seen as equals. And in that way, they kind of open up more in a more natural way. And then they're more invested in the problem when they know they make their own decisions by themselves instead of just being told what to do and being punished. And then the process wouldn't come as natural if it wasn't for the peer program. Next slide.
So why is peer-to-peer work so effective? We're a constant presence 24/7 on campus. It's available on both scheduling and on-call service. Peers are also Antioch High School students of all grade levels, and they're just familiar faces on campus. They can be easily identified by our shirts and badges. The program is consistent and trustworthy. Students and staff are aware of the program and know how to access it. Staff support students being pulled from their classes to address social emotional issues. It lightens the load off staff on campus. Students trust their peers and tend to be more honest and willing to work with them. Next slide.
Yeah, thank you.
And then, okay, so what are one-on-one meetings and mentoring? Mentoring is creating curriculum, questions, and activities for ninth grade students. Mentoring is similar to one-on-one meetings, but the focus is on helping incoming ninth grade students transition to high school. The activities and meetings are based around getting to know the students better, helping them feel comfortable, setting goals, answering any questions they have about the school, and checking in on them weekly. This lasts for at least the first quarter of the year. And then one-on-one meetings are where we meet with students of all ages who just need a listening ear or some extra support. There's no curriculum. Meetings can be one-on-one or one-time thing or a weekly thing or as needed.
Brendan, can you tell us about one of your one-on-one meetings or mentoring experiences that you've had?
Okay, so I'll tell you about one of my one-on-one meetings at the time. So the first one I ever did, it was kind of, I got thrown into it. And it was an hour and a half long session. And it just started off, basically the student was struggling with grades. And he didn't know how to like balance high school life because he was a freshman. And he kind of didn't understand like how to balance the outside class activities with the class activities. So it started off with him just wanting to get his grades up. And then it ended up with him talking about like family issues at home that were bothering him and preventing him from getting his work done. So it's kind of like we found an area where a quiet time period where he'll be able to get his work done without the struggles of being at home. And then next slide. What is conflict mediation? Two peers and two students only, done in main office conference room, very structured to identify needs and make sure students feel heard. Meet with students separately first to see perspective, ends with a contract created and signed by the students involved. And then I just want to put emphasis on meeting with the students before, because it's more like of a natural process that you have with the student where it really gets them to like open up about the situation and tell their side before they get in the room with the other person.
Can you tell us about a mediation and or a successful mediation that you had and why you felt good about it or felt good to you and to the people who you were mediating?
Yeah. Okay. So successful mediation that I had, it was more of like it was preventing a group fight from starting on campus, which involved like almost over 10 students. So me and another peer would bring in two students who were said to have problems with each other. And it all resolved in miscommunication in a way with the two students because they knew nothing about each other. It's just what they heard from another person that was creating the conflict between them. So they figured out that problem. And then they said that we need to talk to two of their other friends that actually had a problem together. And it ended up being the same thing with them and so on. So it was all just miscommunication at the end, which prevented a major fight on campus with a lot of students.
So you didn't mediate all 10 of them together?
No, not together. Two at a time. Which was a long process, but it didn't really matter if we figured out the problem at the end. And then next slide.
So what is PIE? PIE stands for Peer Intervention Education. This program is designed for peer-to-peer support. The PIE participant will explain why they use and alternatives to using. We also help them set goals related to their use and to decide if they want to change. Us as peer advocates are not there to like help them change, but here to help them explore why they use and explore alternatives to using and to help them set goals related to their use. Our PIE program is a pilot program with the CCCOE, which is the Contra Costa County of Education. The PIE curriculum was created together with the CCOE and TUPE and the Advanced Peer Advocate 2 years ago. All peers are trained once a year by the CCOE and are certified in being able to do PIE meetings. Advanced Peer helped during the training. The meetings require parent notification and approval and are often used instead of suspension and part of our discipline matrix.
Well, is it weird to talk to people about drugs and alcohol when you do a PIE?
Me personally, no. One, because we don't really go into detail about the drug, but more of why they use and what are ways to help them stop using.
Could you tell us about a PI that you've recently done?
So I've just finished doing a PI. We talked about why he was using, and he mentioned a lot that it was about mostly stress from work, and we found some solutions of alternatives to doing instead of like smoking when he's stressed. And he found out that hanging out a lot with his family helped a lot. So,
and did you feel good helping him talk about his use and setting some new goals?
Yeah, because when he came to meet with us, he was or meet with me, he was in the process of quitting, but he wasn't sure if he was ready or how ready he was. So throughout the meeting and the meeting, he figured out that he was ready, and he didn't want to continue with his use. Next slide.
So start with hello and community building. For start with hello, we as peer advocates in our class, we went out and did chalk drawings and just like kind messages near the entrance of our school. And then the first day of start with hello, we did a kickoff rally where we basically just handed out like candies and just welcomed people to the school. And then we did some lunch activities, as well as we went to some classes and did some icebreaker games and activities. And then we did a circle just to try and make people feel welcome and just important. And then we do warm for the holidays. So basically we just set up toys and hand out groceries for people who need any sort of food. And then we try and encourage the ninth grade classes to do circles weekly. And then we do activities with students who have high needs twice a year. And they're in a self-contained classroom and can feel not as included in campus activities. So we do our activities with them. And their classroom is right next door, so it also builds a connection and familiarity with the students. Next slide.
This is my slide. So the peers have met with students for one-on-one meetings, mentoring, or mediation over 230 times since the beginning of this school year. The peer advocates have served over 700 students this year. This includes in conflict mediations, PI meetings, one-on-one meetings, mentoring, community building circles, lessons in the classroom, activities led by the peers, and then of course there's the peers themselves. Next slide. All right, so I'm gonna ask, do I have a few minutes to ask our peers some of these questions?
Yes, you do.
All right, excellent. Malia, come on. Malia, we will start with the bottom one. What is something that could be improved to make our peer program stronger?
Although I do think that our peer program is very strong, one thing I could say about our peer program is that we do like the ninth graders to, or we do like to do circles with them. And I feel like a lot of the times when teachers try to do them on their own, like when we say we encourage them, but a lot of the times when we encourage them, they're either not really paying attention or they're very rowdy. And I feel like, especially us as peers, we see the improvement when we do circles with them, us in the classroom. So I feel like we could definitely do that a lot more, besides start with Hello Week, which we do that. But I do think that it can be implemented a little bit more.
Thanks, Dom. Come on up. What's one thing, Don, that that you've learned about from being a peer, or just share an experience about being a peer that is memorable for you?
Should I answer both or just one?
Whatever you want.
Okay. One thing that I've learned from being a peer is how to be really patient and welcoming. I think that was one thing that was really hard for me, was like taking things slower and trying not to rush things, as I am a very fast-paced person, I guess you could say. So peers helped me to like kind of calm down and slow down.
All right. Thanks.
Yeah.
So Lolly, what's one thing you're proud of that you've done while being a peer?
I feel like something that I'm proud of is I've definitely opened up more. I've always struggled with my communication skills, and being in this program honestly has helped me communicate more with my peers.
Oh, thank you. Brendan, pick any of the questions, pick whatever question you want.
One thing I'm proud of while being a peer is working with a specific student throughout my entire junior year and just watching him grow as a person, because he not necessarily had like older siblings or family members that looked out for him in a way that like taught him life outside of school, like the things you wouldn't learn without doing them, but without getting in a lot of trouble. So really just watching him grow as a person without making big mistakes that he could have if we didn't talk.
All right, and Brendan, tell a little bit how peers changed you from maybe 10th grade to senior year.
It really changed me in like a talking aspect. So in classroom, especially, I wouldn't talk unless I was asked a question, because it was really just focusing on my work and then that's it. So really opening up as a person and talking more about my problems or what's going on, and not just doing my classwork and going home and playing sports or whatever I do afterwards.
Thank you. All right, Kira. Either one, top two questions, take which one you want.
One thing I've learned about from being a peer is just trying to be more patient and not judge people so quickly by like first impressions, because you really don't know what's going on with them. You don't know the undersurface level of things. You just know what they show on the outside.
All right, and last question, any one of you can take it. How do you think our work has helped our campus community? Does anyone want to jump in and answer that one?
Yeah, I can do it. I think it's helped our campus community because I think when it comes to like mediations and stuff, a lot of the time there's just a lot of miscommunication, and I think it really helps to just for the students to know what exactly the other person is thinking that they have conflict with. So I think that really helps. And I think just having someone that you don't really know, like have someone you're able to talk to that you don't really know, but you know isn't going to like spread anything, it's really helpful to the students.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you all so much for answering those questions and for sharing each of your all's experiences. It was so inspiring to hear about the direct impact you have all had on the students in your high school. We did get a few questions in the chat. Anyone is welcome to answer these. One question that we got from Christina was, where can you meet with a student? Is there an adult supervisor? If the peer support is happening during a designated support time, where could you privately meet with a student?
So with like mediations, we do use, there's like private like counseling rooms in the office that we are able to use. And then we also have a room that's right here in the back that we can use. But sometimes we just try to find a place like where there's not a lot of people on campus to try and talk to them.
Our peers group is a class, and we have two sections of it. So during first period and fourth period are the times they pull the students out of class, and they meet various places around campus, but all the work is peer-to-peer work.
It's great to hear. And does your school have a wellness center or a peer tutoring class? If yes to either, do you work with those programs?
Our school does have a wellness room, although I don't believe that we connect with each other. And then peer tutoring, we do not have peer tutoring, or at least not yet. And for the wellness center as well, they will sometimes refer people to come see us. If a student is having a hard time or if they just need to talk, they will send them to our room. But other than that, it's just mostly us being here.
All right. Another question that we got was, are students referred to your peer programs instead of getting suspended?
So when it comes to like PI, they usually get a choice on whether they want to be suspended or they do the PI program so they're not suspended. But if they don't if they don't comply with it, then they do end up getting suspended.
And then also with fights on campus, the suspension is either shortened if they do decide to talk and have a mediation between the person and they got in a fight, the person they got in a fight with, because they really want the issue to be solved and resolved rather than them being suspended for 3-5 days, whatever, and come back and do the same thing again.
That's great to hear. This is a question that is for each of you, but if you feel comfortable answering it, how has this work impacted what you would like to do for the future, career or passion-wise?
Oh, I can answer that. So I really love psychology, and I want to become in a profession where I can use that type of work. So I do take interest in therapy and counseling and stuff like that. So I feel like being in the Peers program has helped me learn what I would be learning just earlier on. And it does help me for college, because now that I am in Peers, sometimes colleges will see that we have certification for Peers. So there's some classes that we don't have to take because we already went through.
Yeah, I feel the same. I'm also taking psychology right now, and I think I just really want to be able to help people in some type of way. Not sure yet, but definitely something like that.
So I would like to become a teacher. So my inspiration came a lot from Ms. Weitzer. The way she communicates with this class and connects with the students here, I find it really inspirational. So I would like to continue with this, the skills here that we use.
Yeah, and then the peer strengthening just helped me all around, just interacting with people and interacting with new people in general, not really necessarily a career afterwards yet, but within my sport as well with baseball. Interacting with coaches become just way easier and be able to ask questions without feeling nervous or anything.
It's kind of similar. It's kind of just there's a lot that I do that peers helps me with, especially communication wise, because I would say at first I wasn't really good with talking to new people, and I definitely knew that was a skill that I needed to learn, and being in this class definitely helped me with that a lot.
Thank you all so much for sharing. All right, can we please get a final big round of applause for all of our presenters, to the adult allies that supported them along the way, and to all of you for being an incredible audience. We hope you all have learned a lot from today and have taken inspiration from the presentations, and to remember that peer counseling programs are not a one-size-fits-all. It was incredible to hear from all of our youth leaders presenting today, and it's clear to me that the work that you guys are doing is helping our communities thrive, and I know that you're all going to continue to do amazing work. We could go back to the slides, please, so that I can share contact info. Here is the Adult Allies contact information if you would like to get in touch with them, or if you have any further questions that have may not been answered today. CSHA is also hosting a webinar next week on LGBTQ 101. We will drop the registration link into the chat if you are interested. If you were inspired by today's presentation to start or expand a peer-to-peer program, there is currently a grant opportunity. To learn more about this grant, check out the link that we are dropping into the chat. And then here's our contact information as well in case you'd like to get in touch. And once you all exit this webinar, a short eval page will pop up. Please let us know your honest opinion so that we can improve our next webinars. And remember to be on the lookout for the webinar recording, and we hope you all have a great rest of your Wednesday and to stay safe. Thank you again to all of our amazing presenters. You all did amazing.